I like the attack of the jungle champion pool here for Invictus Gaming. If there's any way to upset a rookie as he's about to come onto the main stage to play his first game of the MSI play-ins, just triple ban him. That'll do the trick.
Yeah, they're really looking to force Fongvu into a particular direction with all these big engaged junglers being taken off the board. Rek'Sai could look to be a priority, but the Jace is still open. You would imagine that for Xeros, that'll be the first thing that Fongvu will want to grab for themselves.
And you see how high the priority on the Jace is, because one of the first pick champions that Fongvu went back to towards Plains was that Galio. So the fact that they're banded away from Pallet, probably his best champion to free up Xeros' champion pool, indicates who they think the carry is.
Now they want to lock in the strong jungler themselves. If the Rek'Sai priority isn't going to come from the side of Fongvu, then Ning will grab it. And we do know that if he's going to invest time, it's going to be towards the top side of the map.
And now, Vedius, I know you're a commentator that loves to comment on the champions as well as the people using them. Game number one of today, we saw a Jace versus a Sylas matchup that was very heavily Jace favored. We have the potential right now to see the flip side of that matchup on Summoner's
Rift. We potentially do, but it very much depends on how much jungle involvement happens towards the top side of the map. And we will see how things play out, but it could definitely be a great example of what the Shy can do, even when he's in a losing matchup.
Well, let's see how that plays out. Suhao, of course, the substitute jungler here for Fongvu Buffalo. Hovered the Camille, I would like to believe. That is a call out to IG's World Championship skins before he flicks over to the Elise, and Picoro will lock in the Kai'Sa. For me, it was the most impressive AD carry that I have seen him play, and he's one he already has experience with over in the MSI playing stage.
Yeah, and it does lend a little bit more towards that scale. But the thing I love about Picoro's Kai'Sa is his ability to join team fights in the river very quickly with it. This is a team that will utilize CC to allow him to fly up, get in the team fight before the opponent, and then be able to take over. He's had so many carry performances.
Now, this Varus pickup is the first of the MSI group stages, which is a little surprising considering how much priority there was on this champion during the play-in stages and expectations coming into the tournament. So what IG are suggesting is they already have a strong bot side. Anything you pair up with the Varus is typically very good in the 2v2. And this again further reinforces to me that Ning is going to be looking to play towards the top side of the map, and Jack11 Baolam will look to play the defensive safe side.
And the removal of volatility, once again, Nautilus has been seen in the mid lane. Not sure how much practice has been coming through. However, was a major part of the play-in stages. So removing that on the side of IG, I would like to see the Buffalo attack Baolan here, take away some support picks, try and get a volatile lane, and already we see the Tahm Kench.
So Tahm Kench has been removed from the pool. Braum still open and available if they wanted to go that route. A couple seconds left to figure it out, and then Invictus Gaming now start to decide how will they round out their team composition. What is Rookie going to look to run in that middle lane? And more importantly, how early will we see PVB get involved? Is Alistar taken away from Palace?
Yeah, apparently IG like the let's remove some support champion pool. Wonder if Baolan has something special in store for us today.
Well, it's a double-edged sword, right, Spawn? Because right now, if the Braum is not banned, then it gives an easy pickup for Invictus Gaming, and then there's nothing left for the enemy team to play against, right? Like, with everything taken away, you're now kind of forced onto something like a Morgana, which, sure, it does provide you with a bit of lane pressure, but not having that melee support can be rather painful.
And this is why I don't like doing things by half measures. You ban away the LeBlanc. Sure, it's one of the scariest champions in Rookie's hands, but now you give over the last remaining strong melee support.
I think this is really dangerous locking in the Zoe. Yes, it is one of Rookie's best picks, but then it's just asking him to play his Syndra. You're asking Rookie to play one of his best ever champions into the Zoe, which is a very favorable matchup for him. So I think this is a dangerous, but we said for PVB, you know what? Just go for it. And right now, they're looking to play early game. They're looking to play aggressive. They're looking to get
into phase. Do it, do it, do it. Pike, Pike, Pike. That would be the support I want to see. It's early game. It's in your face. And it's locked in. Pike, Kai'Sa.
And whilst it wasn't the exact same jungler, this is a very similar comp to what we have seen time and time again in the playing stage for this team. The ability for this Zoe to get out of laning phase early, sure it's into Rookie Syndra, and control the Ripper.
Rookie Syndra
was instrumental in the Buffalo's first match. They're gonna have to do it against one of the best teams though.
Okay, so if we zoom out, let's focus a little bit more on PVB's keys to victory with this team composition. I see a lot of poke, but I also see a fair amount of dive in.
Yeah, so what we saw actually when they played something like Zoe was that they tried to control bottom lane River and then just throw projectiles through River and isolating top lane matchup. Now, do you want to do that against the Shy? I'm not so sure. Maybe there will be more priority put on the top lane. However, that was their key to success that they've shown previously in this tournament.
Yeah, it feels to me that Fengwu Buffalo have very much a 1-4 composition with the Zoe, a lot of poke available to them, very good at playing around objectives, and excuse me, they have a lot of early game options and a lot of roaming. I wouldn't be surprised to see Palette roaming a lot around with Suhao and them trying to make plays, especially towards the top side of the map, try and get Zeras ahead on this chase so they can be this big threatening split pusher.
Because if mid lane is isolated, if top lane is isolated, there is no way you cannot give the stacked deck right now to the Shy and Rookie, the two powerhouse solo laners. But that's not what the Buffalo do. They get out of lane. They try and close in on you. They try and force these 5v5. I want IG to fight fire with fire.
And while I don't really want to make this prediction, I've got to do it anyway. Mid lane's going to die. It is a Syndra and a Rek'Sai duo. There is only a teleport on this Zoe. If you get locked in, you're going to die.
Well, just as we went into that, if you're mid lane null, you're going to die. That was the call as Ning and Rookie with Rek'Sai and Syndra will be able to bully it. But the man on your screen, Suhao, substituting in for Meliodas from the play-ins group stage. Can his Elise have any impact? My eyes will be on him to start off this game and listen to that crowd in Hanoi getting behind the Fengwu Buffalo.
So top side of the map is where I'm looking, but if we already keep our eyes on the minimap, notice where Braum is. He's taking a very cheeky path in through the lane, and it looks like the IG might be setting up something crazy at the level one.
Zeros is in vision, and I think the Shy just showed there, but has CC in his kit level one, so you're right, this is the potential for IG to start this game off with a bang. In saying that, I would have loved to see the Buffalo go for something. I would have loved to see a bottom lane stack around that Tri-Brush, potentially trying to get Vision down early, because I feel they do have to try and rock this apple cart to get something to shake loose.
Yeah, I certainly agree. Now, what we're seeing in this early game is typically mid laners or players will want to try and ward that Pixel Bush at around this time of the game, 1:10, 1:15. But unfortunately for Invictus Gaming, Jakulov was forced to ward early bot side because Baron went up top lane for a potential play, maybe a counter play. And also in the top Pixel Brush, Suhao was able to clear that out by picking his W first and getting that bonus attack speed. So there's actually not a huge amount of vision available in the river to spot out where exactly Suhao will be going for and contesting for this early scuttle, which could make Ning's early pathing a little bit difficult.
Well, we keep our eyes on it. You can hear the calls out as Zeros was unable to find that Shock Blast, and Rookie and the Shy already getting a lot of early damage down. The Shy at level one, continuing to trade, but Zeros with that Mercurial hammer, currently putting the autos down.
And you might think, what the heck is he doing? He's not CSing, but he's stopping the Shy from getting level two. He's building up this wave. That would, in my opinion, indicate that they want to get Suhao up here early, potentially even look for a dive.
I mean, look, we can see red buff into walls, into blue buff, potentially the scuttle as well, and then that will allow Suhao to look for that dive up towards the top side. It's very dangerous early on, but at least level three, one of the best tower divers in the game.
Oh man, I'm keeping my eyes on it. There was a couple pings there on the Shy as we take a look down bottom. Jakulov and Baolan, they pushed the wave in very, very heavily. Big Koro is just being hammered on by that rain of arrows. And Bone Skewer will come out. Yes, that does tag Baolan, gets stunned up for an auto or two, but it's simply not an equal trade and definitely not on the right target.
And one of the most oppressive laners to play against is Varus. Superior range, combo damage there, inbuilt attack speed in the kit, just so loaded. And you can see that right now the short range of Kai'Sa is struggling with it.
So you can see now Suhao did get the level three by doing the Gromp into Scuttle, but Ning is topside as well. He's hanging around, he sees where the jungler is, and both junglers will know of the enemy presence. Suhao, he should have seen this cue from Ning.
And note the difference from game one. Are they still going to go for this? Because there is no mid lane priority. They can't get the uneven numbers here, so the Shy should still be able to catch this wave.
All right, Ning is sitting around. This is a 2v2 in the top lane. Suhao gets some damage onto Ning, but the Shock Blast misses. Instantly, Fengwu Buffalo back away. Rookie and Null have not left the mid lane. And as it stands, Suhao has not left the top lane. Bone Skewer again will pull Baolan out of the tower. does not even take a tower shot for his troubles. And Rookie is getting the pressure in the mid lane. Now the Shy, he gets jumped on. That was a flash from Zeros, but they're currently getting zero. That's a defensive flash away from the Shy. Zeros goes down. First blood to Ming. Repel up, drop down. Suhao's running for his life. The Unbaru sends him flying. And as the Fangs get sunk in, the Shy helps get a double kill for Ning.
Fongvu Buffalo wanted to make the early play happen. Their whole game plan was play towards top side, but Ning loves to support his top laner. They go for the 2v2. They get outplayed. IG lead with 2 kills.
And the important thing was how early Ning was there. He read the play. The Shy communicates when the wave is going to crash. This is a coordinated lineup. I think once the initial dive was gone, it becomes a force, and you can see flash to try and set up the straight line skill shot, read like a book. The Shy outplays it, and then Ning just able to play cleanup.
They were flashing in a little square. It was Zeros who flashed forward, and then there was a flash to the right, and then a left, and then a down, and they all just kind of went around each other, but Ning was the one who was the most happy because he flashed last, and he managed to get that knockup, which then mitigated so much damage, and they were able to turn that fight massive.
And you hate to be overcritical, but you would have loved to have seen the slight knockback from the JSQ actually in the bottom lane.
All right, that's a flash forward into the bone skewer. Really nicely done by Pallet. That was beautiful.
And this is why fans want to see them play towards the bottom zone. They went top. It fails, you go bottom, Pallet sets it up and able to grab the kill.
But look at where Ning is right now. They're pinging on the top side of the map. There's no flash for Zeros. They want to try enable the Shy, but Zeros is full information of what Ning is up to.
Yeah, I think Zeros has got that ward, obviously, and that means he knows to play a little bit defensive. That replay, I hope we do get one. Pallet flashing forward, gets the bone skewer and flings Jackie Love over his shoulders. Suhao still lingering around as here comes Ning. Jumps forward, throws out the Prey Seeker. The ward hasn't timed out yet, but now the Shy, he chases all the way forward, puts a lot of damage back and forth, and Ning still not leaving. He's just firing out Prey Seekers as if this were an ARAM Rek'Sai. Now Zeros continues to push forward, and Zeros currently even CS with Sylas.
So this is one of the things for me that I feel often gets... we'll get into that in a second. First, let's have a look at this bot lane play. Pallet dives in. He forces the flash out from Jackie Love with a good stun. Then Balan does what he can to block the cocoon, but unfortunately the damage has already been done, and Jackie Love with the teleport has no sustain, which means that he's going to get locked down, more than enough damage from Big Coral and Pallet, which means they end up getting a kill towards the bot side of the map.
And you can tell IG just want to scale through this lane. They know that there is kill threat because you can see Balan has gone towards the heal. They've got a teleport there for Jackie Love. They were hoping for a war of attrition here, but that's not the case, because it swings in favor of the Fongvu Buffalo bottom lane.
Now, the point that I wanted to make a little bit earlier was that while the Shy often gets a lot of praise for being a very good player, one of the things that often gets overlooked is that Ning enables him so much. This guy spends so much time playing around the top side of the map, and we just had a perfect example of it where he was sat on a ward. Ning probably knew that Zeros knew, and he was like, I don't care. I'm going to watch you, and you're not allowed to approach that wave because my top laner is farming, and only he is allowed to farm.
Yeah, too many times we see the 2v1 outplays, you know, at level 11 as the game has progressed, but you miss the story of how the lane got to that current state. And it doesn't even cost Ning all that much. He's on the superior farming jungler right now. You knew that the Elise was trying to get proactive as well at the same time. So, not even behind in CS.
All right, good chunk of damage down to Null. You can see the gold values on screen. Rookie and Jackie Love up 15 CS apiece over the respective opposite numbers. Plus the additional gold from First Blood and the extra kill. Invictus Gaming are 1,000 gold up at 7.5 minutes. And Fongvu Buffalo are playing the way we anticipated. Up the tempo, try to be proactive, look for those kills, and it is, of course, Suhao and Pallet that's leading the charge.
And look, Summoner's Rift is on their side. They've given them an Infernal Drake, so if they get another pick bottom lane, potentially they can look to start a snowball. Once again, I think that this pace is even, like, maybe a little bit too slow. I want to see Suhao just continue to visit lanes. I want to see Sork Boots come out. This guy needs to have a proactive early game and just bounce between, you know, potentially these waves.
Oh, Ning's top again.
Yes, he is. Zeros is going to put the hammer down. Ning does not get caught by the cocoon, though. Here comes Suhao. Now the Shy is going to try to turn this around. He transforms into that cannon form. It's a double kill for Fongvu Buffalo.
And the substitute jungler in and already has 3 kill participation, has been everywhere on Summoner's Rift.
And this time, the Shy does not get the 2v1 outplay. Suhao is there to support his top laner, and PVV leads with the kill.
Listen to that crowd with the 2 kills picked up. PVB close that gold gap that Invictus Gaming had accrued, and Suhao will also steal away the red buff.
And one of the most crucial things about this 2v2 is which jungler goes first. Because as we saw when the top initial 2v2 happened, Elise tries to go in, but then Rek'Sai comes in second. So the jungler that approaches second is always going to be in the better position. So this time round, Ning, even though he knew that Elise was there, they thought that they could just straight up win the 2v2 again, burst the Jace beforehand, but they don't pull it off, and it is PVP that come out on top.
Yeah, and potentially critical itemization because we saw the Hex Drinker rushed here. Miss knock up, very nice buffering there. And Xeros just avoids enough damage that Suhao can come in. And the reason it is the way that you're describing, Vedi, is both of these champions' way of getting into a fight is their way of getting out of a fight. So once you've burnt the cooldown, you don't have it available when you need it most.
Well, I'll take a look at the player reactions. The Shy, not too disappointed.
We're in bot lane again.
Out. We jump down to the bot lane. Baolan is down. Suhao once again, 2-1-2, 100% kill participation. And I asked the stats team to throw this up before I knew that kill was coming. These two teams combined kills per minute, on average nearly one kill per minute. You can see IG just ahead. Kills plus assists at 15 on average, 2.7 versus 1.7. These teams kill a lot. Whoa, here comes Big Koro. He's gonna flash over the wall.
He thought about it, but my word, Fongvu Buffalo, this is exactly what we wanted to see from this team. You have nothing to lose, so just play your style. Throw everything at the wall, and right now it is everything that is sticking onto IG.
All right, now Ning is in a little bit of trouble. He's gonna dash forward. Take a look at the damage from Big Koro. Here comes Pallet, death from below. That's another on the board for PVB.
And this was the Warrior of Raz. He said that IG play to their opponents. If you want a tango, they'll go with you. Ning just flies over the wall. That's craziness there, Medius. Like, just dives into two members and gets picked off.
And now Fongvu Buffalo pick up the Infernal Drake. Yes, CS advantages are being built up for Invictus Gaming in bot and mid, but the gold is in favor of Fongvu Buffalo.
And the Summoner's Rift is just against them. You know, early game, especially in the bottom lane, looking so dangerous. It's going to be a mountain next. The Snowball Dragon's coming across. This is what I'm talking about. This is, you know, a mixture of arrogance and cockiness coming together in the fold. And Ning, at this point, can do nothing. He's used everything to try and get in.
There is a fine line between confidence and arrogance, and we are seeing that line being crossed right now by many Invictus Gaming men.
Bone Skewer's channel is charged. He's gone fishing for Baolan. Defensive flash, and there's the Chain of Corruption starting to spread. Teleport completes from the Shire's Palatine.
That's some trouble.
He's going on a Ghost Water dive. LPL is in the bottom lane, and it's Big Koro that kills Ning. The cocoon passes out one as Big Koro is now taken down. The Shire's trying to turn this around. Somehow, Gnarl and Xeros have got some kills. Invictus Gaming continue to fight. They're caught between two towers. Bone Skewer goes out. That's a catch onto Rookie. The Shy's fighting three. The Cocoon locks him down. And Fongvu Buffalo, they get another kill.
Vietnam erupts as Invictus Gaming are falling to Fongvu Buffalo. Oh my god, Rookie. He's just basic. Will he get out?
No, he will not. The Unleashed Power comes out and Gnarl misses every skill shot. Gets killed by a Rookie, but maybe 10 minutes later than expected.
Suhao might be next. Don't go in.
All right, there's the Volatile Spiderling. Suhao fancies a shot. Teleports now.
But I'm slowing down.
I think that's Khaki Lab. There's Scatter the Week comes out. Here comes Big Koro. Now Big Koro and Suhao looking for an additional kill. Xeros, he's now find them. That's the hammer down at the Jackie Lab. Here comes Pallet. Where's the Bone Skewer? Needs to find a target. Baolan's ready for his life. I need another play-by-play as the Void Rush jumps up, dashes down. That's a kill to Suhao. That's sinking the fangs onto Big Koro. And Pallet's going to escape with his life for now. What a passage of play.
Fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice, shame on you. Finally, Invictus Gaming show up to the party, able to return some kills.
Oh my, 17 kills in just under 13 minutes. This is an LPL game if I have ever seen
one. It's a BCS game, Teddy. This is what we're used to seeing from this region. It's why so many fans love them. They're just throwing everything.
Okay, let's take a look now. Pallet is going to be in some trouble as Ning makes his way down. Taking stock of the situation, it's an even gold game. 10 kills to 7 as Ning can choose to burrow onto Pallet here, but the tower plates are the current focus.
Yeah, and whilst we're getting hyped over the fights, notice where the fights are happening. Every time, it's on Fongvu's side of the map because Invictus still pushing in, still generating these lane advantages.
And we got a note here that while it is very exciting, Jaculov actually built up a massive advantage just now because the death of Big Koro meant that Jaculov could pick up two, maybe even three minion waves in the bot side and secure so many extra tower plates. So that CS advantage is not just about CS anymore. There is so much gold in the back pocket of IG's bot.
And this looked incredibly dangerous because the hook was on and five members started leading in. Once again, these champions, once they go forward, are not great at going back, but credit to the Buffalo, they read it, they also get their members down there.
Yeah, they certainly do, and look at how much time is bought with the stopwatch, the mobility of Pyke, the fact that the rappel was used, and then Big Koro, he's the first one to drop, but you're trying to dive this tower. This tower does so much damage, and now Zeras, he looks like he's in trouble.
Yeah, he is. Oh, he gets the shy! That was a 1v1 until Invictus came to bail him out. 3-3-1. And Zeros' Jace, I think he's waking up, Spawn.
Yeah, he certainly is. In saying that, still Rift Herald plus a kill for the bottom lane trade, rotation into the top lane of IG, and this is why they're the total package. They really do put it together on Summoner's Rift. The kill goes across, but still ahead of the play, in the right position now to try and siege out this top lane turret.
Oh, Pallet's very bold. If you look at the minimap, Suhao's only just about arriving, and there wasn't much support from Gnoll, and you know, keep looking, despite the action, despite the fact that Fongbu are opting into these plays, they've lost a tower, they've lost a bunch of plates, they're behind 1,000 gold again. And while Big Koro will even this one out, it is still Invictus that is taking the punches to the face, but hitting back much harder.
I mean, we gotta remember that while we describe this as an LPL game, a VCS game, like, the competition in LPL is slightly different from that of VCS, and when IG get thrown into this environment, you have to argue they have a little more experience. And the fact that even after losing so many members in that bot dive, they still end up coming out on top.
In saying that, let's just celebrate for a moment because this is the one-on-one play. The Shy looks to take it in the creep wave. Very key dodge of the skill shot CC there means that Zeros comes away with the 1-for-1.
Yeah, beautiful stuff. The 1v2 outplay that so many praise the Shy for ends up going in favor of Zeros, the big carry top laner that many fans have been waiting for, who didn't really show up in the playing stage.
No, he did not. And this time round, picking up that solo kill in what is a favorable matchup, let's not, you know, disregard that for a moment, it is a good sign. And you can see with Fongbu, they've grouped up around this Mountain Drake. They get the cleanse out of Rookie, and it looks like they have thrown down that Rift Herald. So this will just, again, allow additional time and pressure into the lanes to maybe unlock this Mountain Drake.
Yeah, however, they're keeping Zeros in the top lane, so potentially just looking for the smarter macro play. No teleport available means that he's just accruing himself some gold. And you can see the Shy misread that, maybe thought he was going down river because deployed towards mid lane and will lose his turret.
One item spikes have been picked up here, Spawn. You can see Luden's Echoes, Blade of the Rune King, Stormraiser as well. The Rift Herald has now been dealt with and the dragon still stands, but PvP, they're going for the objectives. It's a tower that is going to be the focus. Jaculov does get slept, but there's no further CC. And that's three quick towers picked up by Fongbu Buffalo.
And this is where the poke pump comes online. One item spikes are plenty. You can see projectiles flying across.
All right, Rookie gets caught out for now. Bowline's there to save, and Biggest of Koros not going to follow in with the ultimate. But look at Ning. Flash available to him, and the dragon has been started.
It's another fight, gentlemen. Are you ready? Warm up your voice, Quickshot, because blood is about to be shed.
Let's take a look. Gnoll is going to find the Sleepy Trouble bubble onto Ning. That is the most crucial target. Pallet is going to look for a target to hit, will not find one yet.
Oh.
And surprising, surprising amounts of trepidation here from PvP.
Yeah, and maybe IG also, you know, just looking and saying, can we fight them right now?
Yeah.
They're in a current stage of power, and if you remove nameplates, this is a team that now has two Drakes, even gold, against the current world champions.
Well, Zeros throws down the Ghost Blade. He may get caught out, though. He's decided to chase onto Rookie. Turns back into the cannon form. The Shock Blast will not find its target. Here comes Ning. Chilling Smite, flash for flash. Zeros is now trying to escape. The Void Rush will tag, and I'm looking at the support. No one's around, but there's a 4-on-3 being set up in the mid lane. Can a fight start? PvP unable to initiate it.
So overzealous play there from Zeros. He thought that he had caught Rookie out, but Ning was lying in wait in the river to help support his mid laner should anything come to hurt him, and they're able to turn that around. So now Zeros now sitting at 4 deaths. The action has been intense, the action has been high pace, but you can see IG reclaim their 1,000 gold lead.
And this is the worry that continues to plague the Fongbu Buffalo lineup, is those individual mistakes, taking it one step potentially too far. you can see, doesn't have anyone in the area to be able to back him up, and already Ning rotating in.
Yeah, I think you're highlighting the map here is a perfect point here, Spawn, because you notice that full priority is in favor of IG in the middle lane. And the thing is, for Ning, it's easy for him to follow. Even though he used this flash initially, he has the ultimate to then get over the wall, and that's enough CC and setup for Rookie to then come and pick up the kill. So a bit of a greedy play there from Xeros. He needs to pull this back if he wants to stand a chance of taking down IG.
I mean, Invictus still have 1,000 gold lead, despite all the drama and the chaos. We looked at those stats earlier. Both of these teams, in their games in their respective regions, are close to 1 kill a minute over the course of Spring Split, and we're bang on par
for this game. Yes, we are.
I would, however, like to point out that the 1,000 gold lead is on the Rek'Sai primarily, and that's not a champion that you would necessarily want to have the entirety of your gold lead on. Heading into a mid to late game, if this devolves into team fighting, Rek'Sai is not the most useful champion in that regard.
Can I ask you to suspend nameplates for a moment? I know it's hard. If you just look at the compositions, which we'll get to in a moment or two, the Sleepy Trouble Bubble that's going to find a target. Jackie Love is down. PvP have got two. But here comes Rookie. Unleashed Power is going to get dodged away from thanks to that stopwatch. It's a 5-on-3. Boneskewer won't throw the target. The Shy's trying to turn it around. Look at that burst damage onto Rookie. Here comes Pallet. That's a depth from below. Gets the flash out of Rookie. Now Ning, he's going to go down. PvP have got 3 quick kills. The Shy and Rookie hold onto the tower for now.
You know what, Quick Shot? I can easily take nameplates off for this game as the Shy gets slapped.
The Bone Skewer comes out. The Shy stays alive a few seconds longer, turns it around in a 1-for-1 trade. But it's Fong Vu Buffalo that will get the tower as well.
And you have to criticize Invictus for contesting these objectives, because every single time they do, it goes in Fong Vu's
favor. Is that
favor.
A Varus flag that we're seeing right now? Invictus game and they're going in.
They are indeed. That's a defensive flash from Null. He's running for his life. Jackie Lab, I actually think, got helped out by that Bone Skewer. He teleported in, finds himself a kill, and now IG are on the offensive.
The initial mistake came in from Invictus Gaming overextending in the middle lane. They got collapsed on by Fong Vu Buffalo, and as you identified, Spawn, they then continued to go for the fight.
And this has devolved into a little bit of a scrappy tavern brawl, because you can see that resources are being used in ways that we're not normally used to. That fight was won by a flanking Varus,
yes,
teleport, and flash. Now, that is not the most convincing way to win a fight on an international stage, and I think that IG are really buying into this way too much for comfort.
And of course, Invictus Gaming, they are the defending world champion. They picked up the LPL title. This is their first showing at the mid-season Invitational, and there was a storyline that we were debating and discussing backstage about whether or not Invictus Gaming would play to their opponent's level and style. And I think we're seeing a resounding yes right now.
I think exactly that is what we're seeing, which is why we really wanted to see Fong Vu make these aggressive plays. Because if you're going to catch Invictus Gaming off, it is to try and beat them at their own game. Don't be afraid of these players. Sure, Rookie and the Shy are good, but they are still human. They can make mistakes. They can be beaten. And as we are seeing in this game, they happen.
Well, as much as we like to pretend that it's not the case, they still have to play the champions with the same QWER as everyone else does. So when you get them into this situation, when you have a poke comp that has strong setup, and you are in a 5v2 scenario, they will win the fight.
So beautiful stuff here from the side of PvP. They notice that Invictus Gaming is split up. Even though the Shy has the teleport, the duo dies far too quickly. And IG, as you guys were talking about earlier, they just go for every single fight.
And they have no business contesting this. This is 2 summoner spells used on their mid laner. They throw their jungler in there as well. If that's not enough, at this stage, they're still looking to pressure out the turret against what is primarily a poke comp that sets up sieges so nicely. This isn't perfect execution. Fongu in trouble?
Yes, they are. Null's gonna get not taken out. He survives. I thought the piercing arrow would kill him. Pallets and Suhao trying to escape. Here comes Ning, once again looking for a target. Chain of Corruption will take down Null, and Ning with a Furious Bite. Not gonna be enough just yet. 2 quick kills to IG.
So they set up the map well. This time they bring the numbers to the area first. Xeros still splitting in the bottom lane. They'll start up Baron.
All right, Baron is gonna be focused. Teleport is going to be channeled here from Xeros. Smite is available. No, it's on cooldown for Suhao. Xeros like shooting fish in a barrel. Accelerated Shock Blast goes in. That's a lot of damage inside the pit. There's the Bastion with the hammer. Xeros gets Ning. There's no Flash Smite available. That's another onto Baron. The Baron is picked up by Suhao. Fong Vu Buffalo have survived and stopped the Baron.
But it's still an ace for IG. They walk away with 2 members alive, but no Baron in their pocket.
What is this game?
35 kills in 23 minutes. The VCS representatives are going blow for blow with the world champion.
So it starts off with Rookie landing a good stun onto Gnoll. And with that chunk of damage done, and with five members, Invictus Gaming know they can commit to this. They find the initial pick, they turn it into another one, and now they have five members going up against the Baron. The problem is they have no tank that can soak up most of this damage. You can see they get lower and lower, and the poke is coming out from Big Koro, from Zeros, and then Zeros just commits to killing the jungler.
Yeah, and the brave play here is to flash the wall in Hammer Stance. Does so much damage. The steel, the icing on the cake for this lineup, looked like Baron was all but forgotten at 113 health.
Unbelievable. As we come out of it, it is 1,000 gold separating these teams, this time in favor of PVB. The Mountain and Infernal Drake sits in their favor. And look, the maximum gold difference over the course of the game has been 2,500 gold, and it has swung back and forth. Pallet's going fishing. I'm waiting for the skewer to charge up. There is a Drake going to be in the pit. It is available for one of these teams to fight over. And at the moment, there's a part of me that thinks PVB could do this.
And look, whilst not the most valuable Drake in League of Legends in the air, probably will be the one that starts off another brawl.
Notice how, right now, PVB don't actually want to start the fight. They're keeping IG at arm's length and just throwing their poke out. This is how they want to play this composition. Going for the straight 5v5 from the beginning could end disastrously for them.
And I like this decision. Try and force IG away from the mid lane wave. This is the area of the map where you can catch them with the trouble bubble. In saying that, IG send Rookie back towards it, regains priority, and forces Fongvu out.
So the poke slowly continuing to come out from this fog of war. PVB are in control of the top side, but IG have priority over the mid wave, which means that you gain a lot more control, allows you to move into the enemy jungle and start setting up vision.
Oh, I'm so tense. The observers are doing such a good job of highlighting Invictus Gaming's, you know, a vision and the decisions that they're playing with. You can see the skill shots flying out through Fog of War. Jackie Love holds onto that Chain of Corruption as Zeros is now pushing the top lane. And for the time being, Invictus Gaming, they have thwarted all remaining Baron buffs. They put damage down thanks to the Shy's hijacked Jace form, and now they are waiting for another engage.
But while all this darkness was happening and this dance was happening, Zeros actually ran towards the top lane to secure the tower. Unfortunately, Invictus Gaming weren't prepared for this, don't have a wave, which means they can't trade objectives. So PVB actually come out on top, but no teleport on Zeros right now, so IG can look to commit.
Oh, look at that damage from the Paddle Star. Rookie is going to be able to walk away for now. Zeros has not left the top lane. He is sticking around. Black Cleaver, Ghost Blade, more of Malmortius into Ludens and Hourglass. So if he wanted to pick a fight with the Shy, there is a small item discrepancy, but Ning is waiting in the wings in the top quadrant.
And Pellet starting to frustrate the IG lineup time and time again, looking for the hook. Now IG, they go back to a little bit more of their style. Let's attack the side lane. Let's try and wrestle some control back. But you can just see that without the Rek'Sai Tremor Sense there, it is so hard to track the pike around these little skirmishes.
So let's have a quick stock of the items, quick shot, because like so much has actually been bought in the last few minutes, and we're only 27 minutes into the game. We're already at things like third items for some players.
And what items do you like, Vedius? Because of course, Phantom Dancer picked up by Big Koro, as well as the Rage Blade. You've got Morella Nomicon, Ludens Echo there for Gnoll. He's also sitting on the stopwatch. That could be crucial in what has been an insanely chaotic series of fights. But Jackie Love sitting on 3.5 with that recurve bow after Mercurial Scimitar, Blade of the Rune King, and Rageblade.
And I could be wrong, but the only other item that does build out of recurve bow is going to be potentially Wit's End here, something that I like to see. Pallet might be caught out.
All right, there's the engage onto Pallet. He's going to look for the stun on the shine. Not going to find it just yet. Zeros puts the hammer down. There is Suhao. He's going to use that stopwatch for now. A lot of damage on the back end. The Shy is on a killing spree. He's taken out Zeros. That's the team fight, the 5v5 that PVB don't really want.
Exactly that. Quick shot. Ooh, we see another engage onto North. Flash even being burned from the side of the Shy. But this time, the big powerhouse of Zeros, he has been taken off the map. IG have all five members alive and a lot of ultis still actually available. Rookie and Ning, big damaging abilities that if they land that crucial CC, could swing the fight even further in favor of IG.
All right, Baolan throws up that Unbreakable. He blocks some of the damage. Will get put to sleep in a moment. Pallet gets the Bone Skewer. He pulls the Shy all the way backwards underneath the tower. Pallet set that one up. Now Rookie is chasing forward, looking for the Unleashed Power. Claims will buy some time for him. Baolan gets caught out once again by the Bone Skewer, and Gnoll stays alive thanks to that stopwatch. Ning, Void rushes out. catches a target. It's a one-for-one trade. Death from Below comes down, and that's a rappel up to dodge the Scatter the Weak. Cocoon onto Bowland. The shield is up. Rookies are stepping forward, but his ultimate's already been used. And Big Koro does not fancy a shot. But here comes Zeros. He needs to get that accelerated shock blast down. He needs to find a target, and it's not going to land on the Rookie. That's a flash forward. The hammer's dodged away from, and Rookie kills Zeros into the fountain once again.
And top lane is just taking turns in trading their lives into the rest of the team. Bowland is crucial in these team fights. His positioning on Braum in the last two skirmishes have clinched them for Invictus. These coin flip players for IG in Bowland and Ning starting to really show their worth.
But also props to Rookie there. That was a fantastic outplay, saving his summoner spells for the last second, avoiding so much damage. This is where the fight actually kicks off. I don't know if the Shy plan to land the stun, but it ends up working out in their favor as Gnoll and the rest of PUB are being zoned away from Zeros as they IG effectively turn this into a 4v1. They then set up the siege, but here we see Shy making that crucial overstep where he tries to trade onto a pallet, but then he gets dragged underneath the tower, and further chaos just continues to ensue.
Yeah, it certainly does, and you thought that Rookie had gone too far, but Bowland expends his summoner spell, had already shepherded four members away. No, you can't flash away from Rek'Sai. The interaction doesn't work that way anymore. And we're just going to go into another bit of a tussle.
Yeah, but look at the minimap.
Jungle.
Look at the minimap. Zeros is teleporting towards the inhibitor. If PVB can keep them under wraps, this is a potential inhib. Now PVB, they're fighting on two fronts. Gnoll's making his way from the east. He's going to throw those power stars into the pit. Sleepy Trouble Bubble goes in. That's already a kill onto Rookie. Now the Baron's going low. The Shy's picked the fight with Big Koro. Death from Below comes up. Big Koro might be winning the fight. Inhibitor is down. It is Baron secured by Invictus Gaming. But Zeros is on the Nexus turret. The longer this fight goes, the more damage Zeros can do. That's another kill, this time onto Su Hao. Nexus turret number two is being focused down. Fong Vu Buffalo, they're pushing onto the Nexus. The turret falls, and now there's a retreat. Bowland and Ning, they've made it back in time. Let's look at the minimap. Gnoll may be able to come up. Void Rush comes out. Zeros will get taken down by the tower. And with the Baron, this is an advantage to IG, but their base is exposed.
Ooh, that was a close series of events. Invictus Gaming secure the Baron, but then Nexus is exposed. This is still an insanely close game. The gold is dead even. There have been 45 kills in a 31-minute game. Who could have expected Fong Vu Buffalo to push the world champions this far?
And the choice to race here by the Buffalo is so brave, but it fits the comp. They've got so much poke. You can see the kill already picked up. Big Koro looking for the outplays on the current best top laner in the world is able to survive for so long, and it looked like Fong Vu nearly had this.
And huge props to Jackie Love there, because unfortunately for Su Hao, he did not have his flash available. The only way he gets in is with the rappel or just walking into there. But an ultimate from Jackie Love came out at just the right moment to stop him from getting in range to allow Ning to secure it. So big props to the AD carry for IG for helping his team secure the Baron.
Fong Vu Buffalo have secured more than double the amount of towers they took from Team Liquid in an entire best of five. They've got an exposed Nexus against Invictus Gaming. This is the VCS stepping up and dragging Invictus Gaming down to their level and beating them with experience right now. If there's one thing you have to take away, nothing goes as planned in group stages anymore, and PVB are now going to have to fend off this Baron threat if they want to look for the win.
Look in the top lane. You've got to see that there is an Elise and a Chase looking for the back door. They just want to try and sneak their way in, and if they can just secure this Nexus, then they can win the game, which is forcing IG to be, like, they're in two parts right now. They can't decide what the best decision is.
And they are splitting. You can see already the Shy heads back into that top lane, trying to stop this push. Ning's coming also.
Oh, what more can happen? Ning has joined the fray. 2v2 jungle top, how the game started, maybe how the game ends. The mid lane is under pressure as Invictus Gaming are pushing into the tower. Void Rush comes out from Ning. Ning will be able to get the stopwatch from Su Hao, or Hourglass rather, but the base still stands, and what goes up must come down. Ning is on a killing spree. There's a 45-second death timer.
Yeah, desperation creeping into Fong Vu's matchup. They have already had their base broken. IG looking to push in. in.
All right, take a look what damage can happen. Zeros is now in a 1v2. But remember, while this fight is going on, the base defense stands. The inhibitor has fallen, though, in that 3v3. Ning will pick up the kill. Baron-empowered minions now pushing into the base. Big Cora's got the GA, and he needs to have a team game-saving moment. Pallet's not going to be able to find a target as Null trying to throw out those paddle stars. But Pallet gets blown up where he stands. Now, Wit's End was completed by Jackie Love, and he is obliterating the objectives. GA has popped. Jackie Love is single-handedly destroying Fongvu Buffalo. He picks himself up the triple kill. He turns his attention to the Nexus turret, and I started to believe, but it was a bridge too far. Invictus Gaming will take down Fongvu Buffalo.
And they do it through the three most unlikely positions. Baolan, Ning, and Jackie Love, very nice performances in what was a scrappy game. And you feel like the solo lane's buying into it, maybe a little bit too much for comfort.
I mean, I have to give so much props to Jackie Love, because I feel like in the chaos, he was the most consistent performer throughout the entire game. His positioning was good. His flank TPs swinging fights back in the favor of Invictus Gaming. He really stepped up for the team when they needed him to. And unfortunately for Fongvu, I felt like that in the final moments, they just couldn't quite decide how they wanted to try and end the game. And that is when Invictus Gaming, they relied on their individual mechanics and decision-making to then swing it back in their favor in the final moment.
But with the substitute coming in a game that they said they did not expect to win, they took the current world champions to the very edge and were almost peering into an Nexus destruction there for a brief moment.
If you are SK Telecom, Team Liquid, or the Flash Wolves, fear Fongvu Buffalo style. Just so you know, that was the third highest kills in any MSI game ever.
G2 fan, I'm terrified of this team.
Listen, to break down this display of peak League of Legends, I sent it over to the State Farm analyst desk.
Thank you very much, QuickShot. This is my peak League of Legends. 50 kills in 33 minutes game time.
Can we erase that? Can we take that? Can we hide it?
That was just an absolutely insane game from start to finish. The fight and fire out of the PVB squad here coming out on stage for their first game in the MSI group stage against the defending world champions.
And now you're leaving the floor to us to break it down, but I'm gonna just start with an analogy. This game really felt like Invictus Gaming with a kid in class who didn't do their homework, and then the teacher's like asking them for answers, and they're like, you know, they're trying to fill in the blanks here with their gameplay, because for sure they looked past the Buffaloes here in this game and just thought they could play their style, which we know is fast and aggressive, and then it would fit in because their players were better. And we got a hell of a ride trying to work out where that all ended. But I think the IG victory, to me at least, seemed inevitable, but the manner to get there was, oh boy.
The strategy that they went for is something that a lot of LPL teams actually fail to go for, which is like legitimately focus on the top side of the map. Take away the Jace, go hard on towards like an Elise dive composition towards top side and challenge the 2v2, because when that's happened versus IG, they have actually failed a few times.
But normally if you try and do that and then you do what we just saw in the replay,
you can't kill over,
waste everything and you die, it should go horribly wrong. But then Ning is like, nah, listen, I can also do something horrible on top side. He didn't even get the knock-up or anything. He gives a bunch of kills back to him. I actually think PvP, they got surprised that IG were almost crazier than they were in how many plays they could force.
Stare down.
It wasn't the standard of a team who wants to play slower, who's forced to play fast. It was just two teams who were like, let's just fight everything.
That has been the weakness of IG in the past, a weakness where they pick up every fight. Earlier on in the regular season, when they've gone up against Avicii Gaming, LGD that they've lost to, they've been a team that says, oh, you're playing aggressively. Even if it's not our composition style, we'll match you just because of it's a pride thing.
And we had the play there where it was like an IG five-man gank bot side into an invade to the enemy jungle, into respawn from both teams coming in to kill. And of course, you know, my LCK analyst brain is like going off in the back, what are we fighting for? What are we fighting for? And we were fighting for pride, guys. We were fighting for a lot of pride, and it went, and it was up
kills,
and down. It was topsy
turvy. Bloodshed.
It was something amazing.
So I've had the pleasure all split of listening now to team comms, you know, doing games, and you kind of get a feeling for how pro teams are communicating and what they're looking for when they're setting up plays and so on. And you know, their slow setups, fast setups. I really want to listen to comms in these games. Because I imagine there's 10 people actually just screaming into
just
their mic.
I could kill him. Like, I could kill him.
Constantly. And there's never anyone saying, hang on, what's the next play we should do? It's just that we're already fighting, dude. Get over here.
There is no setup here. Just get in and fight. And to be fair, I mean, I'm sure there was a lot of screaming in comms. Let's talk about the audience there, the hometown crowd. I mean, watching their underdogs in Feng Wu Buffalo challenge the number one team in the world at this point. You know, I mean, what a way to start this tournament off, even in the loss, right? To have gone toe-to-toe with IG like that.
Legitimately, you are riding off adrenaline, especially at that point in the game. Inhibitors open up. The crowd sees the Jace teleporting into it. And so you, at that point, the game could end at any point. I had to book it to the desk. The moment it happened, I was like, oh, okay, no. I'm literally going to be late to my own dang segment.
Another play that called for a massive cheer from the crowd was the Baron defense. The first Baron
out
of Feng Wu Buffalo in a 3v5. Oh. Man, they come up big.
Yeah, and they're all hiding behind the Baron, so they take so much damage. Three members coming in, obviously from PvP, to actually just start killing people left and right. No one knows at this point if you're supposed to finish the Baron or fight, so you just end up hitting whatever is right next to you. And in this case, it ended up being obviously IG members who stayed alive, but no Baron for them. It went over to PvP, sadly. I think Pyke respawned like a second too late.
Yeah.
The most sane human being on Invictus Gaming that entire game was Jackie Love.
I'd say Rookie.
Rookie?
So it's at least
that's
some
fair. Look, that's true. He takes some of it. I think Jackie Love, of course, in that replay, being able to clean up so the Baron wasn't completely picked up by the MET. And on top of that, every time the skirmishes went badly for IG, they just went back to being able to, you know, chip up the turret platings and the bots out of the map, so there was always still some semblance of focus on the squad.
I think we can make like a naughty list from this one. Like, who actually misbehaved really badly?
DeFizio's naughty list. Tomorrow on MSI Countdown.
We'll be on it. Who misbehaved in this game, like, the most?
You tell me. You're the one who's making the list.
I'm looking at the two top laners.
Okay, yeah. The Shy was very naughty.
I'm definitely looking at two top laners. I think Ning deserves to get on the list as well.
100% it's Ning.
Wait, more than the Shy?
Yes! Every time he just tunneled right in, I was like, do you have anybody
all right,
near
he's
you?
Even the top All right, he's number one on the naughty list.
For me, 100%.
All right. Help center us here.
That's actually where I want to transition to is, now we have to make sense of the fact that, you know, Invictus Gaming won this game and is 1-0. So is, you know, TL, so is G2. And we're going to have G2 versus IG later in the day. And how can you not say, well,
and
G2 won
prediction.
Dominantly against SKT. I actually haven't predicted yet. We'll get to that.
Yeah, we will.
And then, you know, this was obviously a Fiesta game that eventually was won by IG. But the thing is, we have Raz here to confirm this. IG plays games like this in regular season all the time. They'll be playing, remember, there's like 700 teams in the LPL. So they'll be 1v700. And it will look like this. And everyone around the world, if you watch that game closely, says, how can you believe in IG? How can they be the favorites for everything if they struggle wholeheartedly against teams they should be, you know, beating in almost every metric? IG can shrug these games off and play great. Last year's Worlds performance was IG shrugging off a year of just dominating regular season, playing these sort of games, and then playing standard macro. Yes, they didn't deliver here, but I'm 100% certain they can reset, but we just have to see it to believe it after a game like that.
I mean, it takes two to tango, right? I mean, we know that IG is willing to play these kinds of crazy games. It takes another team to challenge them to go that pace. That's exactly what Feng Wu Buffalo did. We're stepping away. When we return, SKT in the Flash Wolves Clash for Game 4. See who picks up their first win of